Thank you, Bob.
Wow. Those lyrics to that song are amazing. I asked the band and the worship team to sing that song because it's just, I think we often forget, we get used to just coming here and singing and we forget about the beauty of the lyrics. And that song, every time we sing it, it's just something clicks, and it's amazing. So thank you. Can we give the worship band a round of applause? That was amazing. Well, I'm here, finally up here. It's hard to believe that this is happening. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Ethan Morrow. I'm a longtime member here at Bridge City. I've been coming for pretty much as long as I can remember, since I was like this tall, and I'm still here, and I love it here, and my family has been bringing me, and I'm still here. So a little disclaimer, I'm not planning on having a huge in-depth scripture study. I'm not planning on taking one passage and saying, this is what it says, this is what it means for our lives, and this is how we can apply it. I really don't feel led to do that. But what I can guarantee you is that what I'm about to say is Holy Spirit-led. I've been studying it for months now, and this is a term, what I'm going to talk about is a term that when I wrote about it, I was brought to tears. As I was doing this study, I did a word study on this term, and I was just brought to tears by its beauty and its complexity. So, we live in a chaotic world. We live in a broken world. And I don't know about you, but right now there's this really huge sense of unrest. We have this huge sense of unrest in our world, and just this last week, I attended a Shared Hope International donor breakfast. Now, for those of you that don't know, I work with Shared Hope, and it's an international organization that works to fight sex trafficking in the U.S. as well as internationally. And for the past 4 years, we've been focusing on domestic minors. And this last week at the breakfast, I was made reaware of the fact that over 100,000 girls, children, in the U.S. every year are being victimized and taken advantage of. And over 300,000 are at risk. And that breaks my heart. Right now, the U.S. is recovering from, the East Coast is recovering from the brutality of Hurricane Sandy. And you can look on CNN, go to any news site, and just see chaos after chaos after chaos. And as a person who has such a huge desire to restore brokenness, it can often be overwhelming and discouraging to see so much brokenness, brokenness after brokenness after brokenness, and I don't know what to do. It's so overwhelming. I was like, what do we do with that? I came across a term in the Bible that, in my opinion, it fixes that. And in many ways, it makes everything whole again. And I'm convinced that it's something that we have often taken our eyes off of. And that term is peace. Now, peace is an interesting concept. Every society has their own idea of what it means in its fullness. So I decided to go to Google Images and say, I want you to show me, when I type in peace, I want you to show me the top results for what peace is to a lot of people. This is the most used images. We have the peace, not war, that's a big movement. The peace symbols, that's pretty large. A lot of those occurred. And then the peace sign. So I've learned that every society has their own idea of what peace in its fullness is, which makes my job today a little bit harder. But all that stuff here, in my studies, it's not what I'm here to talk about. I'm here to talk about holistic, biblical peace and what that means. And this is what it looks like. These are the images that I think should represent peace. So, peace is an interesting word. Get this, I did some research, and peace, in my translation, the New American Standard, it occurs 370 times in the Bible. 370 times. That is more than the word justice, more than the word joy, and get this, it's more than the word grace. For such a huge term, the word grace, for such a huge term that's central to our faith, peace occurs more than that. So I'm not a biblical scholar. I don't have a PhD like a lot of my professors at Warner Pacific do. But my interpretation is that if something occurs 370 times in the Bible, it must be pretty important. That must be something that's pretty important to God. So there are two words in the Bible that really represent peace. There's a Hebrew word and a Greek word. The Hebrew word is shalom. That occurs about 270 times of the 370. And that leaves about 90 to 100 for the Greek word in the New Testament, eirene. Those have the same definition, pretty much the same purpose, pretty much the same everything. It's just a different language. There are a few minor differences I'd like to note, but those aren't really essential to what I want to talk about today, so I'm not going to talk about those. So do you want to hear the definition? Do you want to hear what it means? Go ahead and close your eyes for me and listen to this and hear God's heart and plan for our world. Close your eyes. The meaning of shalom, meaning of eirene. Total well-being, prosperity, security, completeness, and wholeness. Let me say that again. Total well-being, prosperity, security, completeness, and wholeness. 370 times that concept occurs in the Bible. This concept of peace is clearly important to the God of the universe. So I'm going to focus on the Old Testament a little bit. Of the 270 times that the word shalom occurs, all of it, it's used as a relational concept between God and us, as well as us and the community. So it's a very relational concept. Here's all its different uses. It's used as a greeting. It's used to represent harmonious relationships. It's used to represent a non-anxious presence. And it's used to represent righteousness and justice. Now, that's interesting. I could talk a whole day about justice, but I'm not going to. Then it's used to represent wholeness and being good and favorable. It's all the different uses. It's a very relational term, this concept of shalom or peace in the Old Testament. And I looked through that. I actually went through the 270 times, and because something in my mind was lacking. I was like, something is missing in that. The concept of individual internal peace is missing in the Old Testament. It's not really a focus. It's not there. The concept of shalom is all about obedience. You follow the laws, you do the right things, you make the sacrifices that are required for honoring God, and then the gift of whole relationships, whole shalom, is possible. But internal peace doesn't occur. And that's where Jesus comes in. I'm fully convinced that Jesus brought about, embodied, and gives to us as a gift, not as a result of obedience, peace to all people. He is the one that brings about complete peace as well as individual peace. Isaiah 9:6 refers to him as the coming Messiah, as the Prince of Peace. He refers to him as the Prince of Peace. So something that's interesting, I actually went through, I was going through the story of Matthew, and I came across a section that I've read a lot, but I never read it in the context of peace, and this popped out to me. So this is Matthew 11, verse 2, and this is when John the Baptist is in prison, and he's like, okay, I have been imprisoned for this guy named Jesus, who I think is the Messiah. I better send my disciples and make sure that he is the right one, because I'm in prison suffering for this guy, so I got to make sure. So here's what he says. When John heard in prison what the Messiah was doing, he sent a message by his disciples and asked him, are you the one who is to come, or should we expect someone else? Jesus' response is interesting. He replied to them and said, go and report to John what you hear and see. Go and report to John what you hear and see. The blind see, the lame walk, those with skin diseases are healed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the poor are told the good news. What I think he's saying here is the oppressed and marginalized of this world, the people who were marginalized in society because of their condition, because of their disability, the deaf, the blind, the lame, the lepers, and the poor, they're being cared for. They're being reached. Justice is happening. Completeness is happening. Wholeness and prosperity is being brought about. And Jesus is saying, what do you think? Of course I'm the one. Jesus is the one that was promised. He is the Prince of Peace. Since it's Christmas, or coming up, we're coming up on the holidays, I thought I'd focus on a passage in Luke. It's in the what we call the Christmas story. It's Luke 2. If you have your Bibles, it's Luke 2, verse 14. And this is when the shepherds are met by the angels, and the angels tell them to go see this born Messiah. And so they go. But before they go, the heavenly host opens up. The heavens open up, and they see thousands of angels worshiping God. And this is what they say. Glory to God in the highest heaven, and peace on earth to people he favors. And peace on earth. The most beautiful thing that I find about Jesus is he gifted peace to us. He gifted completeness. He gifted wholeness. He gifted prosperity. Believe it or not, peace, in a way, it's already here. I'm convinced that we've just taken our eyes off of it. You know how I know that peace is here? John 14, verse 27, he's talking to his disciples, Jesus is, and he's talking about what he's going to give them, what's going to happen after he leaves. This is what he says, John 14, verse 27. My peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. My peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. The thing that I feel led to emphasize to you guys is that this concept of well-being, this concept of peace internally, it's already here. Christ has given us peace. It's a gift. In the midst of this chaotic world that we live in, would you dare to believe that at least a part of peace, an internal peace, is already there? Philippians 4, verse 7 says, and the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, Well, guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. In the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Colossians 3:15 says, "Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you are called in one body, and be thankful." The peace of Christ, the wholeness, the completeness, the prosperity, the well-being, let it rule in your hearts. Romans 5:1, "Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ." We've been justified by faith and we have peace with God. Completeness, well-being, and prosperity, security, all those wonderful things with God because of Christ. Romans 8:6 says, "The mind set on the Spirit of God is given life and peace." Guys, the Bible is pretty clear. Jesus is pretty clear. Because of Christ, because of God's gift of grace, God has our backs. Because of Christ, our relationship with God has been made whole, has been made complete, and we can have a well-being, a sense of well-being because of that. He's in this room right now. Our relationship with God has been made complete and whole. Not only that, but our hearts and our minds can have peace through Christ. Our hearts and our minds can have peace and well-being. Why do you think in Galatians 5:22, when Paul's listing the fruits of the Spirit, the third fruit of the Spirit is peace? The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace. There's some other ones, but I'm focusing on peace. That's why I loved the Faithful One song, the one we just sang before I came up, because the lyrics are so true. "Ageless One, you are my rock of peace. Lord of all, I depend on you. I call out to you again and again." Jesus is the one that holds down the fort of completeness, of wholeness. And he helps us bring about all the good things and beautiful things in this world. He helps us restore a sense of peace to the world. It's my belief that through our internal peace, through our sense of well-being, we can then help bring peace to the rest of the world, help bring restoration to the rest of the world. We have peace. It's here. We've just taken our eyes off of it. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for peace, for shalom. Thank you so much for the blessing that you have gifted to us. Thank you for just everything that you've done in our lives to bring about peace and restoration to the broken world that we live in. Lord, all I can do is thank you. So thank you, God, for the peace that is available through Christ, the wholeness, the completeness, the well-being, the prosperity, and the security that you gifted to us. Thank you for that, God. Thank you that you have made a relationship possible. Thank you for everything. Amen.